Hey, hello again, OCC, and hello again to all of you in the bigger, badder, broader YouTube universe. Wherever you are around the world, wherever you are around the World Wide Web, greetings once again. It is Wednesday. It is the last Wednesday of July, and I'm dreaming. No, not really dreaming of a white Christmas, although, honestly, that sounds pretty good. But pretty appealing. But really, I'm dreaming of the day when those of you who are part of OCC can gather in Fellowship Hall once again for in-person, face-to-face, discussion-oriented Bible study. Yeah, that's what these midweek message videos have been all about. You know, the primary objective of these has been to somehow at least partially fill the void left when the pandemic forced us to discontinue, at least for the time being, midweek Bible study in Fellowship Hall at OCC. Thus, these Wednesday videos were born. I, for one, feel much, much more at home and in my comfort zone doing Bible study with all of you in person in Fellowship Hall than I do through this medium of videos on YouTube. Prior to COVID-19, I don't think I had ever taken a video of myself ever in any form. Not on social media, Instagram, Twitter, not on my phone, not on the computer, certainly not on YouTube. This is all pretty much new to me. And I'm looking forward to the day. I don't know when it's going to come. Maybe September, October, November. At some point, we will together decide that it is safe enough to dip our toes back in the waters of face-to-face discussion and Bible study. And I, for one, am dreaming of that time. So, all that is also to say that I've been kind of digging into how these videos are going. How do we begin to measure whether these videos I'm doing each Wednesday throughout the pandemic period since mid-March, how effective are they? And I've lamented to some friends, including some of you who are regular viewers of these videos, I've lamented that we just lack much depth of understanding about that. I can see on YouTube, I can see how many views each of my videos have gotten, but I can't really dig under the hood and find out, well, who are those people? And, you know, where do they come from? How many are from OCC? How many are in different age demographics or whatever? How do they watch the whole thing? Well, a friend of mine the other day said, Rob, I'm pretty sure you can get that information on YouTube. And I didn't know how. So he said, well, I think you have to dig in. You have to click around a bit. But if you've got sort of the login credentials for the channel, which I do, you can find analytics is the key word. And then you can begin clicking around on different things and you can get different statistics and metrics and whatever. And so what I did recently was I took the midweek video from a couple weeks ago, which was one of the more popular, one of the more viewed of my midweek videos for low these many months, and I clicked around. And, you know, first glance, I see, well, it's got 81 views. Okay, now, Jeff, with the Sunday morning videos, he gets hundreds of views. But I, you know, give myself a little slack on that score because, number one, Jeff's the senior minister. Number two, Sunday morning is a more popular time slot and, you know, whatever. It's more ingrained into our sense of what it is to be a member of a church, to engage in some form of worship on Sunday morning rather than Wednesday. And number three, and very importantly, Jeff is good at this. Jeff clearly has a natural affinity for communicating through video. I definitely don't. So when I saw 81 views for this video, I kind of got all excited and kind of patting myself on the back a little bit here. Yeah. I mean, hey, I'm going viral. I'm hot stuff here on YouTube. And then I did some more clicking. For example, I wanted to kind of know, well, how much time do people actually spend on these videos? And here's what it said. This particular video, the average view duration was 11 minutes and 41 seconds. I guess that's not horrible, except that it was a 51-minute video. So that means I didn't retain the audience for very long at all, for roughly a fifth of the video. People stuck with me. Okay, I hope you're still with me. Stay with me out there, YouTube universe. But then I saw this. How about the audience countries of origin? And the number one country was the United States, of course, right? But the United States YouTube audience made up only 38.2% of the audience of that particular video. 38.2%, as I said earlier, the main objective of these videos is to fill the void left when in-person Bible study had to be suspended. I mean, I guess I was hoping that a lot of the 81 views came from OCC eyeballs. And then I certainly assumed that almost all of the 81 views at least came from somewhere in the United States. Now, to those of you watching from countries other than the United States, believe me, no offense, and I totally thank you for watching. I am not in any way discounting the value of your viewership. Thank you for tuning in, and I appreciate it, no matter how many sparse minutes you spend on the video. Thanks for being here and sharing at least a moment or two with me, no matter where you are around the world. But again, I mean, my job is to be the associate minister of a particular wonderful little church in Grafton, Wisconsin, and to help to foster the spiritual growth of 200 or so folks that make up that congregation. The fact that the vast majority of those tuning into my videos are only doing so for a short period of time and are doing so from parts unknown outside the United States, clearly not related to OCC, well, I guess it has me all the more dreaming of the day when we can return to Fellowship Hall to Bible study. So those of you who are regular viewers of these videos, you know we've been talking about S words during the quarantine period. Maybe I myself should add a couple. How about short and succinct? Maybe these videos are a bit too verbose. I don't know. If you have an opinion on that, feel free to comment right below. Folks, I thought I'd share with you today something that has really done my heart and soul a lot of good over these last few days, and that is the return of Major League Baseball. I am a football fan, yes. I'm a basketball fan, yes. But more than either of those, I am a baseball fan. There's something about the game, the nature of it, the nuance of it, the fact that it doesn't have a time clock, that it's the only major team sport that doesn't have a time clock. Baseball is just fascinating to me. And so I thought I would share with you just something that might also give you a chuckle, do your heart and soul maybe a little good. First of all, obviously, like I say, baseball is back. It started last Thursday night. The Brewers opened their season on Friday against the Cubs, an epic matchup of National League Central rivals. I am an oddball among Wisconsinites in that I am both a Brewer fan, first and foremost, but secondarily, I am a Cub fan because I grew up with the Brewers being my American League team and the Cubs being my National League team. And just as I love listening to Merle Harmon and Bob Uecker, I love listening to Harry Carey and Steve Stone. So this was a great weekend. The Brewers lost 2 out of 3, which again, the Brewers are my number one team for sure. So I was a little disappointed by that, but still, it was just great to have baseball back. But something pretty funny, something pretty amusing happened on opening night, the very first game of this bizarre, delayed, shortened, modified Major League Baseball season took place between last year's World Series champs, the Washington Nationals, and the New York Yankees. And it happened on Thursday night, and throwing out the ceremonial first pitch was Dr. Anthony Fauci, who we all know is a rather famous figure these days because of his role as the head of a section of the National Institutes of Health that deals with allergies and infectious diseases, and his role as a member of the White House Coronavirus Task Force. We've seen him on TV and so forth. He had an interview with Jake Tapper of CNN. It was an interview that took place a few days before his ceremonial first pitch. And it was an interview that I heard on a podcast, so it was audio only, but it was a conversation between Jake Tapper of CNN and Dr. Fauci. And that conversation sounded like this.
Finally, sir, I know you're a huge Nationals fan. I've seen you wear a Nationals mask at hearings. You're going to throw out the first pitch when the Nationals face off against the Yankees on opening day, Thursday. Obviously, that's quite an honor. How are you going to do it in a way that conveys that this is baseball during a time of a pandemic?
Well, Jake, I think the atmosphere in which it's going to be occurring is going to be speak that very, very clearly. There's not going to be people in the stands. It's just going to be televised. So I think that in and of itself tells you something about the stark difference between what we're doing right now and what we were able to do last year at this time.
All right. I hope you've practiced. That plate is a lot farther than you think it is.
Yeah, I used to play baseball as a young boy and as a kid in school, and I hope I don't bounce it too much.
Well, if you do, you'll be forgiven. I know you've been busy. Dr. Anthony Fauci, thanks so much.
Thank you for having me, Jake.
And then, a few days later, Dr. Fauci took the mound to throw out the ceremonial first pitch of the very first Major League Baseball game of this modified, weird, regular season. And this happened.
To throw out the ceremonial first pitch. Catching his pitch is Nationals pitcher Sean Doolittle. Dr. Fauci, when you're ready, it's your pitch. Dr. Anthony Fauci.
And of course, one can't help but recall a famous scene from a movie in which Milwaukee's own Bob Uecker had a small part, and he famously uttered these words.
Into the windup in his first offering, just a bit outside. He tried the corner and missed.
Yeah, there's been all sorts of jokes about Dr. Fauci's kind of botched first pitch. I thought one clever one was some journalist said, well, Dr. Fauci very definitely flattened the curve. Yeah, flattened the curve. Another one commented that Dr. Fauci, as a young boy, played baseball, but he played shortstop. So even though he was charged with throwing the ceremonial first pitch, that was his task, he maybe instinctively angled himself toward first because as a longtime shortstop, he was used to throwing to first. Whatever. It was, I mean, I think Fauci took it in stride. Since then, he's made public comments that have been very self-effacing, you know, and good-natured, good-humored, good for him. Good for baseball to be back. But, of course, we know in the last few days, there have been COVID-19-related problems with baseball. There's been an outbreak among the players and coaches and staff of the Florida Marlins. As I tape this video on Tuesday, July 28th, it appears that at least 17 members of the Marlins organization have now tested positive for COVID-19. And that has led to a ripple effect because the Marlins played the Philadelphia Phillies. And now the Phillies are playing the Yankees this week, or supposed to be, so some games have been postponed. And we're quickly learning that the quote-unquote reopening of major sports, starting with baseball, but soon the NBA, and in a month or so, of course, the NFL, that these reopenings are going to be fraught with potential pitfalls. So even though it's baseball, we find ourselves not just talking about batting average and home runs and RBIs and stolen bases and ERA and OPS and WAR statistics and all that, sabermetrics, all that stuff. We're not just using that jargon, but in the same breath, we are also talking about coronavirus-related jargon. And that gets us to our S word for today. The world of baseball, of course, as you know, is, well, it's littered with statistics and jargon, terminology of all kinds, abbreviations, acronyms, etc., etc., and I alluded to some of those a moment ago. The same is true not just of baseball, but of most sports, when you think about it. And baseball, like most sports, seems to be a situation in which the vocabulary just grows year by year. New statistics, metrics, benchmarks are made up. And I don't say made up to be dismissive about it, but I mean they're new algorithms are formulated for measuring who's the fastest, the best fielder, the most accurate throwing arm, what's the best way to measure a pitcher's effectiveness, whether a starter or a reliever, you know, how do we better capture the overall impact of somebody's hitting ability or lack thereof, all this jargon that goes on as part of baseball. And of course, I think we know there's a lot of jargon that's going on related to the pandemic as well. And so, as we continue our series on S-words, and check this out, all of these super S-words that we've covered, if you look down at the very bottom of the list, you'll see today's S-word, semantics. Yeah, semantics. My goodness, there's a lot. There's a lot of abbreviations and technical terminology that a lot of us who are not medical professionals probably didn't know prior to late February or perhaps sometime in March. And I've compiled a list on a slide here that I'll put up on the screen for you. It is not an exhaustive list. There could be more, but these are the ones that I've sort of highlighted. And I'll just pick out a few and say a word or two. I mean, you know, I, for one, kind of looked at novel coronavirus, and I kind of thought, wow, that's kind of weird. What does that exactly mean? It's odd. Well, no, of course, we know by now novel with regard to a disease just means it has never come in contact or infected humans before. So we as a human species are complete rookies with regard to our immune systems dealing with this particular virus. Of course, it's been called different things, COVID-19, coronavirus, SARS, CoV-2, et cetera, et cetera. I think I knew before the pandemic what the difference between asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic was, just from a general understanding of what the prefixes mean. I think I got that part, but I didn't know what PPE meant. And I don't think I had ever heard the term social distancing prior to sometime in early March, personally. I don't know about you, but that was kind of a new one to me. And now it is an everyday, virtually every hour kind of a term that we throw around. I was not familiar as a non-medical person. I was not familiar with the distinction between a respirator and a ventilator. A respirator is a mask like an N95 mask that protects the wearer, such as a doctor, a nurse, an EMT, an ER person, from whatever may have infected the patient. A ventilator is the thing where they stick the tube down your throat, they intubate you, and it's a machine that basically breathes for you on a temporary basis. I didn't really know the difference or fully understand the correct use of those two terms prior to the pandemic. Droplets versus aerosols. We've all heard about that. It has to do with the size of the infectious particles that come out of your nose or mouth when you speak, when you laugh, when you sing, when you cough, when you shout, when you sneeze. I didn't understand all the differences between droplets and aerosols and how they behave in the air and how infectious they are prior to the last few months. Herd immunity, I guess I'd probably, encountered that term at some point, but I certainly didn't know as much, just a couple months ago as I feel like I do now just from watching the news. All of these are words. Now, we may say, it's a bunch of technical, medical, mumbo-jumbo, scientific-type stuff that we don't need to worry about. But words matter. Words, whether they're the S words that we've been going through over these last several months, whether it's the words used to describe baseball and the performance of a particular baseball player, and whether it's the words we throw around when we're trying to wrestle with the implications of a pandemic. Words matter. And to the extent that our leaders and our medical experts have tried to educate us on some of this vocabulary, some of these semantics, if you will, I think that's a good thing. I want to have at least a pedestrian understanding of what the dangers are, what we as a country and a world are dealing with, what are some of the relevant medical terms surrounding transmissibility, surrounding equipment, surrounding projections for the future. Words matter. Words are tools. I really want to emphasize that simple assertion. Words are tools. And in whatever context, words can be powerful tools. The old adage, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. We all know that that's frankly not true. We have all been hurt emotionally, psychologically, maybe socially, by words, by somebody's unkind words toward us or about us behind our backs. But words can also be used to educate and to uplift, to enlighten, to inspire. Words are not only tools, words are powerful tools. And that leads me to lift up for you the scripture passage that I'd like you to contemplate today. I think Jesus had a really good understanding of the power of words, of just what wonderful tools words could be, and just what a positive impact words could make on other people, enhancing their understanding, perhaps providing them with guidance or with comfort or with assurance or encouragement. I think Jesus had a really incredible and intuitive grasp on just what words could do and how much good words could do. And the disciples, it seems, had some at least basic instinctive recognition of that as well. They at least recognized that there was something special about the words that Jesus used. In the Gospel of John, Jesus was, in chapter 6, teaching around one of his I am sayings. There are 7 famous I am sayings in the Gospel of John, and one of them is, I am the bread of life. And he uttered that statement and then expounded upon it, and he started talking about, my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink, and you need to eat of my flesh and drink of my blood. And certainly if the listeners were not entirely on board with the ideas of metaphor and symbolism and layered meaning, but if they only just took it at face value, sort of in a literal sense, well, the disciples and the other listeners may very well have, you know, had a unsettling reaction. It's a bit disturbing on its face. Again, if you're not on board with the idea of symbolism and multi-layered meaning and metaphor, you kind of have an almost cannibalistic sense of what Jesus is teaching here. And yet, once he had gotten through his discussion of this, we come to these verses near the end of the chapter, and notice the conclusion that the disciples reach. Let me read it for you here. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, this teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are Spirit and life. Think about that sentence for a minute. I'll say it again. The words that I, Jesus, have spoken to you are Spirit and life. But among you, there are some who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, for this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father. Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, do you also wish to go away? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. Wow. Peter's conclusion there, and hopefully he was speaking for more than just himself. Hopefully for others of the disciples too. The conclusion reached was, you, Jesus, have the words of eternal life. Words are tools. Words are powerful tools. Words can be powerful tools for good. And certainly for Jesus, words were a powerful tool. Oh yes, of course, Jesus was a healer, a miracle worker. Obviously, he did a great many signs and wonders and ultimately sacrificed himself on the cross and was raised to life in the resurrection. All of these action steps that Jesus took, they're all critically important to our understanding of who Jesus is. But so too are his words. Jesus was known as a teacher. That was a core aspect of how he was regarded by the public and, yes, by the disciples. And a good part of teaching, not all of it, but a good part of it, is words. Yes, you also teach through your actions. You teach by example. There's all sorts of ways to teach, but words are certainly one important way. So Jesus' words were tools. They were powerful tools, and they were powerful tools for good. So semantics, our S word for today, are not something to be treated lightly or to be ignored or to be sort of poo-pooed, you know, like, that guy, he's just playing semantics, or, that's just a matter of mere semantics. Yeah, sometimes that is the case. But semantics matter. Vocabulary matters. Terminology matters. The way we choose and use our words matters. And Jesus was a great example of that. And so, I want to share with you four questions for your reflection today as we get ready to wrap up. First, in what types of situations have you found terminology or jargon to be frustrating? I'm sure there's got to be some kind of a context you can think of where you've kind of been like, yeah, that's just a bunch of mumbo jumbo, or, you know, maybe it's somebody at tech support talking about how to fix your computer, and you want to basically say, hey, in English, please, not just with all this terminology that has to do with, you know, central processors and antiviral programs and all these things that only computer geeks really fully understand. In English, please, you know, just give it to me in simple terms. Surely there is some context in your life or some memory in your memory bank in which you found the jargon, the vocabulary, the terminology, the semantics to be frustrating. And how exactly did that feel, and how did you handle that? Then secondly, be honest here. Are you ever prone to word choices that frustrate others? You may very well have one or more areas of expertise yourself, and it may be tempting to kind of show off just a little bit, to throw around some fancy $10 words when a 10-cent word would do just as well. I know I've been accused of that from time to time, and I'm not really an expert on a whole lot of much of anything, and yet sometimes still I get accused of sort of throwing around words that are fancier than they need to be. So honestly, you know, looking yourself in the mirror and thinking about the way you interact with other people in conversation, do you ever use terminology or make word choices that may result in other people feeling a bit frustrated with the conversation? And if so, you know, what do you do about that? How do you curb your own instincts or your own tendencies to throw around those words? Thirdly, what kinds of positive words are you best at providing to others? Is it, for example, words of advice, words of hope, words of encouragement, words of comfort? Perhaps some other type or types of words come to mind for you. I think that's a great and important question for us to ponder. It's important to understand our strengths. Not all of us can be Dear Abby. Not all of us are probably very good at giving advice that is sound and truly helpful. But I bet all of us can identify at least one type of word-based messaging, verbal messaging, whether spoken or written, that is positive, that is helpful to other people, and that we're pretty good at articulating. And at least one type, and maybe more for you, maybe more than one type. Identify those strengths and then use them. Leverage them. Use your word-oriented skills, your word-oriented strengths to help other people. And then finally, how exactly, be as specific as you can here, how exactly do you see the power in your words? It's not all just about small talk and casual conversation. There can be real power in your words. So try to fill in the blank here. With well-chosen words, I can... And then go ahead and try to complete that sentence. I don't know if you would say, well, with well-chosen words, I can change the world. Maybe. But maybe that seems like a bit of a stretch for you. With well-chosen words, I can brighten somebody's day. That's doable. That's very achievable. You know, so think very specifically. Where is the power for good, that is sitting there within your ability to use words? Where is the power in your words? Now, before I sign off, I need to share with you something that I think OCC members and friends, you probably have seen or heard elsewhere, but I want to be sure we use every possible channel, medium, and opportunity to get the word out here. Starting this Sunday, August 2nd, and running through the Sunday of Labor Day weekend, which will be Sunday, September 6th, we are tweaking our Sunday morning game plan or our Sunday morning routine at OCC. We are, in a nutshell, going to just one service instead of two, and it will be masks required at all times for everybody, including those of us who are speaking, reading, praying, preaching, whatever. And it will be at 9:30, kind of in between. We had a 9 and a 10:30. We're kind of coming somewhere in the middle at 9:30. And we will not be doing any singing, nor will our guest musicians be singing, because we do recognize there is a special and specific and enhanced health risk in having people sing in the sanctuary in the presence of others, in presence of worshipers. So you can see it laid out here on the slide. Children's and youth programming will be suspended, effective immediately, and running through Labor Day weekend. We hope, oh, fingers crossed and hands prayerfully folded here, we are hoping to be able to sort of reopen and relaunch Sunday school, youth group, nursery, and so forth on Sunday, September 13th, the first Sunday after Labor Day. But of course, the virus gets a big vote in that decision, so word on that is yet to come. At least through September 6th, no nursery care, no children's Sunday school, no MP3 youth group. Instead, Amelia, our Joyous Journey Sunday School director, and myself will be doing videos, Amelia for children and me for youth, and we'll be sending those out through email to the congregation, typically on Sunday mornings. 9:30 worship. It will also be live streamed, so that does not change. Meaning, by that I mean, if you are in the habit of being safe and staying home and engaging in worship with us from your home via YouTube, you can still do that, either at 9:30 in the moment live, or later on Sunday or Monday or Tuesday or whenever. You can also access the worship service as a video recording after the fact. And then, of course, coffee and conversation will follow. Because of no singing and some other aspects of our modified worship services during this time, we don't expect that those services will typically be a full 60 minutes, probably more like 45 or 50. And so we anticipate coffee and conversation to begin right around 10:20 on the typical Sunday for these next six Sundays. All right, folks, it's been a pleasure chatting with you today. Again, I thank you, no matter whether you're in the United States or somewhere else, whether you're an OCC member or not at all, thank you for spending whatever portion, whether you listened for the entire time or just a very few minutes, thank you for the privilege of your attention here on this midweek Wednesday. As always, I hope and I pray that you and all your loved ones are staying safe and healthy and well. And I mean that not just physically or medically, but also emotionally and spiritually. Guard and promote and take good care of your holistic wellness, mind, body, and yes, spirit, during these challenging times. And as always, I pray that God continues to guard you and guide you and bless you day by day. We'll hope to see you either online or in person Sunday at 9:30, and right back here next Wednesday for another midweek message. Take care, everyone.